Hello all, welcome to MA3D1. This video is about elementary potential flows. And in this video, I'm going to change my strategy a little bit in response to some of the feedback you gave to the previous video that I posted, which was to write everything as I speak. So I'm going to do that in this video. I've started out by writing something just to introduce, like I would in a normal lecture before the lecture starts. And here is the recap. This is chapter 6 on potential flows. A potential flow is a flow whose velocity can be written as the gradient of a potential. The advantage is that the potential satisfies a simpler partial differential equation. This is the Laplace equation. And many more techniques exist for solving this. Essentially, we are going to see one technique. And once the flow is known, momentum conservation is satisfied trivially by applying the Bernoulli equation, which is written right here. So from this video onwards, in a series of 3 or 4 videos, we are going to examine one theory using complex variables, really one approach using complex variables to solve Laplace's equation. And every time you solve a Laplace equation, you generate a potential flow. This strategy will involve combining elementary potential flows in different forms to accomplish whatever it is that you want to, the flow that you want to accomplish. And here is a list of the elementary potential flows we are going to consider. Out of these, uniform flow, point source, and a point vortex are really the ones that are essential. The next two are just an illustration of what happens when you combine them in some non-trivial ways. And that will be part, I'm going to describe them here, but really their full effect will be revealed in the next video when we consider combination of elementary potentials. So let's start with each of these elementary flows at a time. The first is uniform flow. The format I will adopt is this. For uniform flow, or for any of these elementary flow, I'm going to start with a potential W of Z. This is a complex potential of a complex variable. And in this case, it will be e to the I alpha Z. Let me see if I want a minus alpha there, minus alpha. Okay. Now we break this into real and imaginary part. So we write Z as X plus IY, and I substitute it. And let me do this on the side here. I want to make this product e to the I minus I alpha times Z, e to the minus I alpha times Z is cos theta minus I sine theta times X plus IY, and its real part is cos theta X plus sine theta Y. And the imaginary part is Y cos theta minus X sine theta. Based on this, we have the real part as a function of X and Y, which is the complex potential, is X cos theta plus Y sine theta. And the stream function, which is also a function of X and Y, is Y cos theta. Sorry, which one is this? This one. Minus X sine theta. Now we can, before we plot the flow, we will find the components of the velocity, which can be found in two different ways. I'll use the potential. Oh, all of this is times the u, which is outside here. Let me make some space. To write the u. So the x component of velocity is the x derivative of the potential, which is u cosine theta, and the y derivative gives you the y component of velocity, which is u sine theta. And you can see this, the velocity is independent of the coordinates, which means it is a constant everywhere, and it points at an angle theta. Oh, I don't know why I wrote alpha. There should have been a theta. In fact, I really want an alpha there because I want to use theta for something else, for the polar coordinate. So in the notes you will see I've used alpha, but I don't want to go back and erase everything. See, this is one of the drawbacks of doing things live, which is that if I make a mistake, I don't have the option to go back. But what I'll write a comment here, theta should be replaced with alpha. Okay. So now let me draw the flow for you. And the way you draw this, or any type of potential flow from the potential, is you take, first you take the stream function and draw lines of constant stream function. Now lines of constant stream function are, let me do it on the side, psi equals constant, I'll call it C, it's u times y cos theta minus x sine theta equals C. So y is x tan theta plus C over u cosine theta. Theta is a constant here, theta is not a coordinate, that's why I wanted an alpha. So this thing here is just a constant, and you have y equals x tan theta. Tan theta would be, now that would be the equation of a straight line with slope tan theta, which means it's a line making an angle theta with the x-axis. This is the x-axis, this is the y-axis. So if I draw this curve passing through the origin, it would look like that. This angle would be theta, and so on. So these would be the streamlines. And the velocity potential lines, the lines of equal or constant velocity potential, they would be, oh sorry, I didn't want this, yes, phi equals constant, that would be u times x cos theta plus y sine theta is a constant, and that would give me another equation, y equals minus x over tan theta plus C over u sine theta. So here the constant C could be different. I'm going to choose many different values of the constant C, and that will give me a line which is orthogonal, a set of lines which are orthogonal to the streamlines. These would be the equipotential lines. So these will be phi equals constant. And you see, for every potential flow, we are going to generate this network of lines. The flow goes along the streamlines. So the flow is along these curves. I hate this when it happens. but that's how. I'll try to be more careful with my palm. So that's the flow. That's how you generate a uniform flow at an angle theta. Okay. You vary theta, you get flows at different angles. When theta equals 0, the flow is along the x-axis. When theta is pi over 2, the flow is along the y-axis, and so on. In this case, you will also notice that the pressure will be given by ddt of u times x cos theta plus y sin theta times the density plus 1/2 rho u squared, because magnitude of u is this squared plus that squared, gives me a capital U squared, plus p minus rho g dot x is a function of time. Because u is a constant, pressure would be hydrostatic unless this is a time dependent flow. And what I mean by time dependent flow is that unless this quantity u or theta change with time. A uniform flow essentially means uniform at a given instance in time. At a different instance in time, you could have the flow pointing in a different direction or have a different speed or both. And when that happens, something has to provide the acceleration to change the fluid velocity. And this term here gives rise to a pressure, according to Bernoulli, that will provide that acceleration. Okay. Now, so that concludes our discussion of uniform flow. Now, we'll move on to the next elementary flow, which is a point source. And this is the first non-trivial elementary potential flow we are going to see. The potential for a point source is W of Z is Q over 2 pi log of Z. Let me just double check that's what it is. Yes. Okay. And again, now we have to decompose this potential into its real and imaginary parts. But doing that is not so straightforward. If I substitute z as x plus iy, I don't know how to break it up into real and imaginary part, because z goes inside the log. So we have to substitute a form that is conducive to this potential. And such a form is the polar form. So now we are going to use r e to the I theta for our complex number. Okay. And when I have that, I have q over 2 pi log r. Now, log of z is log of r plus I theta. Right, so that becomes our complex potential in terms of polar coordinates, r and theta. So from that, we can read off our potential. And now, instead of x and y, we will use polar coordinates to represent. I must say q here is real. Okay, q log r over 2 pi, that would be the velocity potential, and the stream function would be q theta over 2 pi. At this point, we take the gradient of the velocity potential to find the velocity. Now, the velocity potential is a function of r alone. What does that mean? That as you go further away, velocity potential changes only with the radial distance, which means its gradient will be radial in direction, either radially outward or radially inward. We'll have to figure that out. It looks like it increases radially outward, so the gradient of the potential will also be radially outward. So when all is said and done, you can use your favorite method to calculate this gradient. And by that I mean you can transform to Cartesian coordinates, do the differentiation and transform back to polar coordinates, or just use the expression for gradient in the polar coordinates, which is this. And that's the velocity you will get. Now, what is this velocity? This velocity is purely in the radial direction, pointing away from the origin, with a magnitude that decreases with the distance from the origin. It blows up at the origin. That's another observation to make. Okay. So now, let's try and make an attempt at plotting this velocity profile. Okay, and in this case we are going to just start with plotting arrows for the velocity based on what we observe here. So close to the origin we have flow that is radially outwards but which is strong, and as you go further away from the origin, the flow weakens but remains in the radial direction. This is my depiction of it. And further away, it's even weaker. Okay, I forgot to write. This is the x-axis and this is the y-axis, but it doesn't really matter because the flow is axisymmetric. Now, what one expects for the streamlines from this sort of a simple picture for the flow radially outwards is that the streamlines would also be straight lines radially outwards, right? So let's see if that happens. So here, let's go to loop streamlines. Streamlines are curves with where the stream function is a constant. So q theta over 2 pi is a constant. So that gives theta is 2 pi c over q. Those are the equations of our streamlines. They're basically theta equals a constant. So which means our streamlines are going to be these lines, these straight lines pointing away from the origin, one for each value of theta. I'll draw eight of them. Right. The flow points outwards for a positive q. If q is negative, actually I'll talk about what happens when q is negative. It's not that exciting, but it's something that we should have in the back of our mind. When q is negative, the flow is inward and the point source is called a point sink. You can see why this is called a point source, because the flow seems to be flowing out of this point, right? We are actually going to characterize it far more carefully than that. Now also let us draw lines of equipotential curves. These are phi equals constant, q log r over 2 pi is constant, and when all is said and done, this becomes r is e to the c 2 pi c over q. That's it. There is one line, one of these curves for one value of c, and r equals constant means a circle. So if I draw these in red, you see how the streamlines are everywhere orthogonal to the equipotential lines. In the previous video I showed you that this is a general property of potential flow, and you see that being realized here. So now I'm going to spend some time in discussing why this particular flow is called the flow due to a point source in two dimensions. Okay. In order to facilitate this discussion, I'm going to consider a curve C, which is simply a circle of radius R. Okay. So now, and from this circle, oh, hang on, before I do that, there is something we should do, which is verify that the flow is incompressible, mass is conserved. So the expression for the divergence in polar coordinates is 1 over r del del r of r u r plus 1 over r del del theta of u theta. This is the theta component of velocity, and this is the r component of velocity. Now, for our flow, we only have an r component of velocity. We don't even have a theta component of velocity. So, this term is identically zero, because u theta equals zero. So what we are left with is 1 over r d dr of r times u r, which happens to be q over 2 pi r, and we have one factor of r here cancelled with one factor of r there, and we had a derivative of q over 2 pi. Q was a constant for our flow, or at least q does not depend on the spatial coordinates. 2 pi is a constant, it's a number. So we get a zero. So the flow conserves mass. The flow doesn't cause mass to accumulate anywhere. Flow conserves mass. Yet this is called a point source, because when you cancel one factor of r, it's necessary r is not equal to zero. Something funky happens at r equals zero. And to understand what that is, we are going to need this circle of radius r, the curve C, which is a circle of radius r. Okay. What we are going to do is we are going to apply divergence theorem to the volume omega inside the circle. Omega divergence of u d omega. This is two dimensions, so this is a two dimensional integral, is the integral of u dot n dA on the boundary of omega. Now the boundary of omega is this curve C, which is a circle, right? So the right hand side is easy to evaluate. RHS is over the curve C. The velocity everywhere is ER, Q over 2 pi R. And the normal is the radial unit vector ER. And the area element, this is two dimensions, so we'll take unit width out of the plane of the paper. And we have R d theta, where theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. Again, here we have one cancellation. R is not equal to 0 for our curve. In fact, R is equal to R, capital R. So, not equal to 0. And ER dot ER gives us a 1. So, this whole thing just integrates to the constant Q. In fact, that is the reason why you put q over 2 pi, so that the factor of 2 pi cancels when you integrate this integral. Now, the left hand side, we calculated divergence of u, and divergence of U turned out to be zero everywhere except at the origin. So one would expect, if the divergence of U were really zero everywhere, the left hand side would also be zero. But left hand side is always equal to the right hand side, and the right hand side is not zero, it is equal to this parameter Q that we substitute. Based on this, we conclude that the divergence must be equal to Q times the delta function at the origin. And because, so what this implies is that mass is conserved everywhere except at the origin. And at the origin, we have a source of mass, and that mass crosses this curve C irrespective of what the radius of this curve is, which means the same amount of mass crosses each of these red circles that I have drawn here. So mass is conserved once it comes out of the source, which is located at the origin. So this is the character of a point source. A point sink would be the same, except that the flow goes inward into the origin rather than flowing out, but the same sort of argument would apply. This is a potential flow, so let's actually do this. Let's calculate the vorticity. Vorticity is curl of velocity, and in cylindrical coordinates, the expression for the curl is 1 over r del del r of r u theta minus del u r del theta, and this is times the unit vector in the z direction. We have u theta equals 0, so that term is 0, and u r doesn't depend, u r is a function of r alone, so has no theta derivative, so we get a 0 for the vorticity. And the same sort of thing could happen for with the vorticity. Then maybe it is zero everywhere except at r equals zero, because we know we have a r in the denominator there. But when we examine the next flow, which is the point vortex, you will see why the vorticity here doesn't even have this delta function contribution at the origin, because the point vortex is the one that has a delta function contribution for vorticity at the origin. The point source only has a delta function contribution for the divergence, not for the curl. Okay. So let's move on. So that's why this is called a point source. So with that in our back pocket, now we will move on to the next elementary potential flow, which is the point vortex. The point vortex has a potential given by I gamma over 2 pi log z, where gamma is real. Okay, and you will see this is a more or less the same potential as the point source, except for this imaginary unit I in front. So again, when you substitute z as r e to the I theta, now what happens is that for the real part of the complex potential, we get gamma theta over 2 pi, and for the imaginary part, we get minus gamma log r over 2 pi. So what used to be the stream function now becomes the potential, and what used to be the potential now becomes the stream function with a negative sign on it. And so the curves that we have drawn here remain the same, except these were streamlines, and the red were equipotential lines. Now they change roles. The circles become the streamline. Let's now draw the circles become the streamlines. And the radial rays become the equipotential lines. So without doing too much work, I can already draw the flow. The flow will be that way. But just for completeness, let's do that. U is the gradient of phi. In this case, phi is a function only of theta. So I get E theta del over R del del theta of phi is E theta gamma over 2 pi R. And you'll see that means the flow goes around in circles like that, anti-clockwise or counterclockwise. Now, this type of a flow is essentially the same as the point source, but rotated 90 degrees. So if I were to draw the arrows, now all I would do is just rotate the arrows by 90 degrees. The velocity still falls away from the origin as 1 over r, proportional, inversely proportional to the distance. So a lot of the things that we talked about, point source, are similar. Now, this flow is called a point vortex, and we've got to justify this name. So let's see what the divergence and curl are for this flow. The divergence is supposed to be 1 over r del del theta of u theta. Because we don't have an r component, I won't bother writing the r component. And because u theta is a function only of r and not a function of theta, this vanishes. Everywhere except at r equals 0. And in order to understand what happens at r equals 0, we had to do the trick that we did previously with the curve C and applying the divergence theorem. And so let me again draw the curve C. So here is our curve C. The volume inside is omega. And that's the orientation of the curve. Now, if we do integral of the divergence of u d omega over omega equals u dot n dA over the boundary of omega. Here you will notice that if I do this on the side, u dot n is e theta and then gamma over 2 pi r dotted with er, because the normal is in the r direction but the tangent is in the theta direction. So this is identically zero irrespective of the value of r as long as r is positive. So the right hand side is identically zero. Therefore, we can conclude that the divergence of u is identically zero for this flow, even at r equals zero. But the same is not true for the curl. Now let's evaluate the curl. Curl of the velocity is a vector in the z direction. And what was the expression again? We want u theta. So 1 over r ddr of r u theta. 1 over r ddr of r u theta. Ur is 0, so I don't need to write the second term. And I have ez hat over r ddr. I substitute u theta is gamma over 2 pi r, and times r just gives me gamma over 2 pi. Now gamma is a constant for this flow which doesn't depend on the spatial coordinate. It might depend on time but not on the spatial coordinates, and therefore this derivative vanishes and we have the vorticity to be zero everywhere at a finite radius, because I have still a r in the denominator, so I need to examine the r equals zero case more carefully. Now we need to use an analog of divergence theorem that would work for the curl, and such a theorem is Stokes theorem. Stokes theorem says that the curl of a vector field integrated over an area is equal to the circulation of that field. Let me see what notation I used in the notes, and that's exactly the one that I want to use here. ds. And I just noticed a typo. Equation 6.22 must have a u dot n inside the integral. No, not a, it has a u dot n. It must have a u dot t for an integral. I will correct this the next opportunity I get. So this is the statement of Stokes theorem. Now I will take the area A to be the disk, which is not a volume anymore. It's just the disk, which I have also plotted in black here. It's just that when you take a three-dimensional volume with unit depth out of the plane of the paper, you get a volume. If you just consider the disk in the xy plane, you get the area A. Okay. Now here again, what we will do is evaluate the right hand side, and the right hand side, the velocity is in the theta direction. The theta direction is gamma over 2 pi r. The tangent is in the theta direction, the tangent to the circle C that we have. And the arc length is r d theta. Theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. A factor of r cancels because r is not equal to 0. and e theta dot e theta gives me a 1, and I have gamma over 2 pi integrated over 2 pi, get gamma. So the right hand side is gamma, the left hand side is 0 everywhere other than at r equals 0. So the curl of u must be gamma times delta, a Dirac delta function at r equals 0. It's a vector oriented along the third direction z hat. So now I'm ready to introduce the following terminology. For the point source, Q is called the strength of the point source. If Q is negative, then it's the its magnitude is the strength of the point sink. I'm not going to be too particular about the negative sign and the sink. You know, if you give me a negative source, I will treat it as a sink. Here, gamma is called the circulation of the point vortex. A circulation is defined exactly by this integral. Okay. In general, a circulation is defined as this line integral. It so happens that when you calculate the circulation on a curve going around the point vortex, you get gamma. And therefore, this circulation gamma is independent of the shape of the curve you take, so long as it goes around the point vortex. All right. So let us be a little more precise. This is a little aside. It follows from vector calculus, but it's worth emphasizing here. So let's say you have point vortex at some point at the origin. Okay, so this is the origin, and here you have a point vortex of strength gamma. Now you take a curve. This is our curve C. Now this integral u dot t ds over the curve C, which, you know, I can also write it as a contour integral, is equal to gamma if z equals 0, the origin is inside C, equals 0 otherwise. And the cases where the curve passes exactly through the origin, that's an edge case, you get gamma over 2. But I'm not going to, we are not going to deal with that special case with great detail in this module. There are applications of that which are extremely important for some numerical methods for solving flows. Not only flows, many other applications as well. These are the so-called boundary element methods for which this sort of consideration becomes super important, whether your curve goes exactly through the point where you have the source. But for our purposes, the terminology is what I want to clarify. Circulation, let me just say circulation about a curve C is defined by this integral. It so happens that by Stokes' theorem, this is also equal to curl of u dA. and the consequence of that is that the circulation of a curve, if the only flow that exists is because of a point vortex, the circulation around any curve will depend on whether the point vortex lies inside the curve or outside. If it lies inside, the circulation will be gamma. The parameter, which is also called the circulation of the point vortex, and if it is outside, then you get a zero, so you don't need a name for it. I'm going to end this video here, because the next two elementary flows, we are going to derive them from these three that we have considered so far. So I'm going to call them derived elementary potential flows, okay? And I'll make another video on it, maybe sometime tomorrow or so. So thank you for your attention, and I will see you in the next video or in the next live session.